Assalamu alaikum students, and welcome to lecture number 17 of this fluid mechanics 2 course. And in this course we will start a new chapter, and this chapter is about the turbo machines, and we will discuss the turbo machines in the constant in the context of our fluid mechanics, that how these turbo machines are used for different engineering fluid applications. And mainly we will talk about two types of turbo machines. You are already familiar with them. One is the pump, and the pump is the one which converts the mechanical energy into the hydraulic energy, and the other is the turbine, and turbine is the one which converts the hydraulic energy into mechanical energy. So in this chapter we will be talking about the turbo machines and the different performance parameters that are required to for these machines to function, and how we can improve the efficiency of these machines, and what are the parameters that we will use to select a proper turbo machine for our appropriate application. So let's start with the introduction. And as we discussed, the pumps and turbines, often turbo machines, they occur in a wide variety of configurations, means they can have a wide variety of power ranges, RPMs, and energy that they consume or supply in case of turbines. Or in general, what they do, the pumps, they add energy to the fluid. So we convert the mechanical energy into the hydraulic energy, as we discussed. So pumps are the turbo machines that convert the mechanical energy into hydraulic energy. So basically they are adding energy to the fluid. So basically they do work on the system, and by system we mean fluid. So to do work on the fluid, to move or increase the pressure of the fluid. And turbines, on the other hand, they extract energy from the fluid, and as we already know, the fluid does work on them. And the term pumps, this term pump will be used generally to refer to all pumping machines. Means, what are the pumping machines? The machines that add some kind of an energy to the fluid. So they include pumps, fans, blowers, and the compressors that you are already familiar with. So these are our turbo machines, and basically our turbo machines will be categorized as pumps and turbines. So this is a very interesting component, and this is known as the turbocharger. And in this turbocharger you can find the phenomena of the pump and turbine on a single shaft. How is that so? Because this turbo machine is used in vehicles, in our automobiles, and the purpose of this turbocharger is to use the energy that is available in the exhaust gases. As you know that our automobiles, they burn fuel, they burn the gasoline. So after that they exhaust the residuals. So those exhaust gases have kinetic energy, and to utilize that kinetic energy, what we do, we use turbocharger. So here on this side of the turbocharger acts as a turbine. As you already know, the turbine is the one that extract energy from the fluid. So this turbine actually extract the kinetic energy from the exhaust gases that are coming from the engine. And as these exhaust gases flow past this impeller, as you see, this is an impeller, it actually rotates this impeller, and at the other end of this impeller is another component, and that component acts as a pump. And what does this do? It actually, these two are connected with on a single shaft. So it rotates this impeller, and this impeller acts as a pump because it is connected with the engine, and it is connected to the compressor of an engine. So what does this component do? It further compresses the air that is going into the engine. So it compresses the air that is going into the engine to form there an air fuel mixture. So this pump component of this turbocharger actually further compresses the air. It draws in more air. It draws in more air. So when it draws in more air, what it does, it helps us with the combustion. It helps us with the combustion. So again, this turbocharger has two phenomena that are occurring on a single shaft, and on one side the exhaust gases are utilized to turn this impeller, and on the other end we have connected another impeller which draws in the air, and that air is compressed, and then that compressed air is injected into the cylinders, and by further compressing the air, what we actually do, the cylinder draws in more air, and when it draws in more air, it helps in the combustion, in better combustion of the air fuel mixture. So it actually helps in increasing the efficiency of the engine, and we also are utilizing the exhaust gas for a particular useful purpose. They are not just exiting into the atmosphere, but we are actually using them for a special purpose to increase the efficiency of our engine. So this is a automotive turbocharger turbine and compressor rotor, and here you can see both the phenomena of a turbine and a pump on a single shaft and how they are used in an automobile vehicles. So to further categorize the turbo machines, there are two types based on the that how the fluid flow direction is with respect to the rotation of the rotor. So again, there are two types. One is the radial flow and the other is the axial flow, and again these two depends upon the two types are categorized based on the direction of the fluid motion. So the direction of fluid motion relative to the rotor axis. So now the direction of fluid motion relative to the rotor axis will define that either the fan is axial flow fan or a radial flow fan, and here this is a radial flow fan. As you see the fluid flow motion, the fluid motion right here is along the radial direction, because it is flowing in the radial direction as compared to the rotation of the axis. So rotor axis, sorry. And in the axial flow fan, the direction of the fluid motion is this direction. It is along the axis. This is the axis of the rotor. This is the axis of the rotor, and the fluid is moving along the axis parallel to this axis. So that's why it's called the axial flow fan. So basically these two can occur at the same time, and they are known as the mixed flow. Mixed flow. So the good example of radial flow fan are impellers in your motor, in your pumps, impellers, and this can be your exhaust fan. The exhaust fan that you see daily is an axial flow fan, and the impeller is a radial flow fan. There is another crucial aspect that we have to include in our analysis of our turbo machines, and that involves the selection of the fluid. That a fluid can either be a gas or it can either be a liquid. So whenever we are dealing with a gas, we will be more concerned about the compressibility effects, the choking effects, the Mach numbers that occur when fluid like a gas moves past a certain turbo machines, and how will it impact our turbo machine, and what kind of forces will it occur on the turbo machines when we are talking about gases. And when we talk about liquids, we are basically concerned about the fluid pressure, that what will be the fluid pressure. For example, if we say that we talked about cavitation, and cavitation occurs when the pressure drops below the vapor pressure. So what the fluid does, it starts boiling, and when it starts boiling, it create bubbles, and those bubbles strike with the impellers, and when it strike with the impellers, and when that bubble burst, it creates a shock wave, a small, very tiny shock wave. But these minute shock waves actually damages the impeller. So that's what we are concerned about when we are talking about liquids, and we are concerned about the compressibility effects and the Mach numbers when we are talking about the gases and when they are large enough. So we have to be cautious that which type of fluid we are dealing with when we are talking about a design of our turbo machine and their analysis. So turbo machines involve the related parameters of force, torque, work and power, and this is what we are going to talk about in the next slide, and how we are going to build towards talking about the force, torque and work and power that are involved in a turbo machine, and what are the bases on which we will talk about these concepts. So let's move forward. So the first thing that we will have to include is the energy consideration, that is the understanding of work transfer in turbo machines, that is right here, that how the work is transferred in the turbo machines by considering the basic operations of a household fan or a windmill. That can be one can be a pump and the other can be a turbine. So we will consider these simple examples, and then we will build towards our forces, our torques, our powers that are involved in these turbo machines. And the first actual phenomena that can actually illustrate the flow across a turbo machine are the velocity triangles, and these velocity triangles will help us to build towards our torques and our power. And then again we will move forward towards the efficiencies and the other stuff that are involved in a turbo machine. So that's why the velocity triangles are important. So first we will talk about the velocity triangles. We will deal with different velocities that are involved in a turbo machines, and how we are defining these different velocities, and how we are building its velocity triangles, how will we draw them. So first, for that purpose, we will see this example of a fan. So as you can see, this is rotating in this direction. This is and let's say an axial flow fan, if you would like to call it, because the air will move in this direction, and in it will exit out in this direction. So here this will be our inlet, this will be our inlet, and this will be our outlet. So we will further go down to one impeller blade, and then we will take a section of that impeller blade. This is a section, and that section is A, B, C, D. So we will take this ABCD section, and this ABCD section will also contain the cross section of this plate. It will also contain the cross section, the cross section of this plate. So we will magnify this ABCD section, and then we will also have a cross section of the blade, and then we will see that how will we perceive the different velocities that are involved in this rotating fan. So let's do that. Let's draw this version, this section magnified, and as you can see, the A, B, C and D section that was shown right here is drawn magnified here, and this right here shows the blade cross section. This is the blade cross section, and as you can see, the rotor was moving in this direction, it was rotating in this direction. So this will be the motion, the blade motion, this will be the blade motion. So this will be the direction of the blade motion, and this will be our inlet surface, this right here, our A and D is our inlet surface, and the exit surface is our C and B. So these are our two inlet and outlet surfaces across the section ABCD, and this ABCD sections also contains this cross section of the blade. So now we will talk about different velocities. One is the absolute velocity, that is the velocity of the air that is going in. That was this velocity, the velocity of the air that was going in across this axial flow fan, and then how that velocity will leave that axial flow fan. So we will represent the absolute velocity as we saw, absolute velocity will be represented as V, and it is called absolute velocity because this velocity and this is the velocity of the fluid. This velocity, for this velocity the reference is the somebody that is stationary on the ground. So if this is let's suppose an observer, and that observer is sitting stationary on the ground, and he is looking at this wind that is coming in across this rotor. So for this absolute velocity the reference is stationary. This is the stationary reference. And that reference is observing that air that is moving in across this axial flow fan. So the reference is stationary, that's why it's called the absolute velocity. Then there is the velocity of the blade, the U. The U is the velocity of the blade. So we know the direction of the blade. The blade motion is in this direction, as you can see. So the blade velocity will also be in this direction. And if the radial distance of these two points is same from the axis, then we can say that U1 is equal to U2. So U and U2 will be the blade velocity. The blade velocity. And there is a third velocity, that is W1 and W2, and that W is called the relative velocity. That is the relative velocity of the fluid that is going in and out. And we call this relative velocity because that velocity, for that velocity W, that is relative velocity, the reference for this velocity is someone who is sitting on this blade, on top of this blade. So if someone is sitting on top of this blade and that blade is also moving, so that reference will also be moving. So if he observes the air that is coming in that axial flow fan, so he will observe the relative velocity of that air. So for this relative velocity the reference is moving and it is attached to the blade. So this is the main difference between these two velocities, the absolute and the relative velocity. And for the absolute velocity the reference was stationary, and for the relative velocity the reference is a moving blade, and then we have a blade velocity. So by combining these three velocities we have a velocity triangle, as you can see, one at the inlet, that is section 1, and the other is at the outlet, that is section 2. So let's clear out some space first because we'll add some notes here. We now know our three velocities that are involved. Two velocities are related to the fluid. One is the absolute velocity, for which the reference is stationary, and the other is the absolute velocity for which the reference is stationary, and the relative velocity for which the reference is someone that is sitting on top of the turbine blade or the fan blade, and the third one is the velocity of the blade. So from this we can actually have our velocity triangle, and if you would like to see it, this is how we can draw our velocity triangle, that is the absolute velocity, the blade velocity, and the relative velocity. And if we can write this in terms of a formula, then we can say that for the absolute velocity will be equal to the sum of the relative velocity and the blade velocity. So this is the formula that will be used further when we talk about forces, torques and momentums, etc. So we will save it for later, but this is how we will represent the absolute velocity as the sum of the relative and the blade velocity. There is also another very critical point to consider, that how will we know that right now we are talking about a pump or a turbine, that if is this fan, the axial flow fan, is that of a pump or is it that of a turbine? How will we know that? And we will know that here we have two components in for this scenario. One is axial, that is along the axis of this rotor, that is along the axis of this rotor, and the other one that is perpendicular to this axis is the tangential component. So these are the two components that we are dealing with for this particular scenario. One is the axial and the other is tangential. So now let's look at the absolute velocity at the inlet, that is V1, and at the outlet V2, and let's observe its direction. Here the absolute velocity V1 has a direction along the axis. It does not have any component across the tangential component. It does not have any component across the tangent. So V1 here have only axial component. But as this fluid flow past this blade and it starts to exit at this point, we have a change in direction for this velocity, and now this velocity is in this direction right here. So it will have both an axial component and a tangential component. So we can say that this change in direction is due to the force that this blade has applied on this fluid. And since if we draw the two components of this V2, we will get one in the tangential direction, that is V2, you can call this T. So now that tangential component is due to the force that the blades applied on this fluid that was moving across this fan, and that force was applied in the direction of the blade motion. So this was the blade motion, the direction of the blade motion. This is the direction of the blade motion, and to change this direction, to change this direction from completely axial to both axial and tangential, the blade will have to apply a force in the tangential direction also. So the force that was applied to change the direction of this absolute velocity at point 2 is due to the force that is applied by the blade in the tangential direction. So this says that whenever the force applied is in the direction of the blade motion, then we say that we are dealing with a pump. And you can comprehend that statement because the pump is the one that is adding energy to the fluid. So it will actually apply the force in the direction of the blade motion. So this actually tells us that we are dealing with a pump. Now we will look at a turbine, and we will see that how will we comprehend the same phenomena in terms of a turbine, and how will turbine vary from a pump. We are pretty much clear now that why this is a pump, because the blade motion and the force that is being applied to change the direction of the absolute velocity and add a component in the tangential direction is due to the same direction of the force and the blade. They are in the same direction, and when their direction is the same, then we are dealing with the pump. And you can comprehend that again, because the pump is the one that adds energy to the fluid. Now let's look at an example of a turbine, and we will see that how a turbine is different from a pump. Now this is an ideal diagram from again from your Munsen book, and this is figure 12.4. Please go to the book and read the statement that is given with this diagram 12.4. So this is the idealized flow through a windmill, and as you know, a windmill is a sort of a turbine that actually extract energy from the fluid. So now let's again take this cross section 1, 2 and draw this cross section here, and then again the fluid is moving in this direction, and when it is moving in this direction, we will have the absolute velocity of the fluid. The turbine is moving in this direction, so the blade motion will be in this direction. So now we see that the blade motion is downward, so we will have the velocity of the blade, that is u1, and then we will have the relative velocity, that will be, that is the velocity of the fluid, that is in reference to someone sitting on this moving blade, and then we have this absolute velocity for which the reference point is somewhere stationary on the ground. So we have a velocity triangle at section 1, that is section 1, and now we will see that what happens to the direction of this absolute velocity v1 when it exits at section 2. And as you can see, the velocity direction changes. The velocity direction changes. So as you can see, the velocity direction changes. So for this purpose, you can see that the blade motion, the direction in which the blade is moving, is downward, but the velocity changes in this direction. So it had only one component, that was the axial component, but now it has two components, that is the axial and the tangential. So for that purpose, now we can see that the blade is already moving in this direction, but since this blade is extracting energy from the fluid, so there will be a certain action and reaction phenomena, action and reaction phenomena that will occur for the absolute velocity to change its direction at this point. So if the fluid is striking the blade right here, and it is actually giving energy to this blade to move in this direction, u, that is the direction downwards, so this blade will actually have a reaction, and that reaction will be in form of a force, and that force P will in the opposite direction, and due to this force, this absolute velocity direction will be changed. As you can see, the direction is changed. This absolute velocity has now two components at section 2. So the as you can see, this is the case for the turbine. This is the case for the turbine, that the force that is applied to change the direction of the absolute velocity is opposite to the direction of this force is opposite to the direction of which in which the blades are moving. So when these two directions, one is the direction of this blade, the blade motion direction, and the force that the blades apply on this fluid are in the opposite direction, then we are dealing with a turbine. But if they are in the same direction, the force that is applied to change the direction of the absolute velocity and the blade motion direction, then we say that we are dealing with a pump. So this is how we will differentiate the pump and a turbine based on the velocity triangles and based on the velocities that we defined. One was the absolute velocity, one was the relative velocity, one was the blade velocity. And again, just to repeat that the absolute velocity is the one for which the reference is stationary. The relative velocity is the one for which the reference is moving, and moving as such that it is attached to the blade, that someone sitting on the blade is looking at the fluid, so that is not stationary, that is moving, the reference point is moving. So that is the relative velocity, and then we have the blade velocity, and how we use these velocities to differentiate between a pump and a turbine. So this was the first introductory lecture into your turbo machines, and we will further use this concept, and that is the absolute velocity is equal to the blade velocity and the relative velocity, and further talk about the torques and the momentums and the forces and the powers that are involved whenever we are talking about the turbo machines. So I hope that was clear. See you in the next lecture.